reinforces what we're all about. We're about bringing the community together, which is the power of the volunteer.
Yes.
And then empowering them. So we have international builds.
Okay.
Youth can go on international build. You can go anywhere in the world. So you want to go to Argentina with us? We'll take you to Argentina with us this year.
And you can go see what's going on. I have a feeling my team, when we're in the car, they're gonna mention that. So we're gonna edit that part out. Hey. Thanks for being in the REC experience. Oh, what? Something looks a little different today? Well, it's the fact that we're on location.
Our backdrop is different.
Well, it is.
We're here at Habitat for Humanity.
They let us borrow their office, their boardroom, their backdrop.
Their people.
Their people. So true. As most of you guys know, about a month ago, or maybe a little bit longer.
Maybe two months ago.
2 months ago. We went.
In the thick of summer.
Thick of summer. Like, it felt like it was 40 degrees up there.
Yes.
It probably was really close to like 30. We were sweating. The team went out and did a build day with Habitat for Humanity. And today's episode, I sat down with the CEO of Habitat for Humanity, Mr. John Gerard, who is
what a character.
What a character. We had such a great time.
Oh my gosh, he came in
with
so much energy.
So much energy. You can tell, their organization is 62 people now.
Yeah, and he's grown it.
You can tell, even when we walked into the office, Laura, and please, correct me if I'm wrong, everyone, big smiles on their faces, right? So much energy.
The culture here, you can tell. And I don't know if it's because everyone just really, truly is passionate about what they're doing, or they believe in the cause, or he just is a great manager and the culture's been great all the way through the organization. But everyone has been so helpful from us from the very beginning when we first reach out to them to help out, all the way to even scheduling this.
And for us, it really was a no-brainer, right? To partner with Habitat for Humanity, because they help families in need with not only housing. Like, that's what people think. Oh, they help just build homes. They do that, and they do that very well.
Yes.
But there's so many other ways you can volunteer.
Definitely. I mean, he was mentioning today that they have sort of three different ways you can help. One of them just being their what's called their restore.
Yep.
Where they're refurbishing furniture and selling it.
There was also, even if you just wanted to be part of their administration team
marketing. Yeah. He said that people could come in.
If you're good at websites or something like
that. Which is totally what we preach all the time. So just do what you're good at and see where you can bring value.
Great tie-in. You know, when we say you could think about working for free to just get a portfolio built up for what you do from a graphic designing. Here's an easy place to start.
Yeah.
Because they need the volunteers. Right now we're in the Halton, Mississauga location. I can tell you, if you're lucky enough to be a volunteer here, in all honesty, because there's probably a lineup, because the culture's amazing in this place. Steven was mentioning, who's playing videographer today for us. Shout out to Clem. He's back at the head office, making sure that
holding down the fort today.
Steven was like, I could stay here all day.
Yeah,
because the culture was so good, right?
Hilarious. It kind of reminds us of us a little bit.
So
all the different characters.
What was your favorite part about the build day?
My favorite part about the build day, besides meeting the lookalike Matt Damon.
Right.
We talked about him a few times. I think mostly off camera.
Yeah. But, amazing guy. Just so much energy.
So not just him. Honestly, meeting the other guys that were on site as well.
Yeah.
One of the gentlemen, volunteer. He's been doing this for a really long time. You just meet these amazing people who are out there every day and with smiles on their faces. We were hammering nails for, 3 hours? I was exhausted.
Yeah.
That is grueling, grueling work. And it gave me such an appreciation for it. And those guys do it every single day. And they deal with people like us who don't know what the heck we're doing.
Yeah.
And they
make it easy.
And they make it easy and they make it fun. And that was my favorite part.
I'm so glad that you got to join us that day. And shout out to the rest of our team. To the ones that obviously came out and volunteered 8 hours of their day to help. And I can't wait to see when the actual home gets built, because it's going to be in the hands of someone that needs it. And thank you to everyone at Habitat for Humanity, not only this location, but locations right across the world, because they are international. Please do what you can. If you're watching or listening, take the time. There's so many ways you can volunteer. This is not a thing where you have to write a check. I mean, they're obviously accepting checks if you just don't have any time. But there's so many ways that you can volunteer. And so do yourself the favor, because it was really an amazing experience. Thanks to you, Alto, once again.
Thanks for organizing this. And enjoy, guys.
REC Experience presents real estate, entrepreneurship, leadership. With your host, Jazz Takkar. The REC Experience Podcast is now on air.
I'm so excited to be on location today in Burlington, in the Halton and Mississauga area. And the reason we're on the road today, and the gentleman that you'll be hearing from, but you see on video next to me, is Mr. John Gerard, the CEO of, essentially it's the Halton Mississauga branch, would you call
Correct.
It? John? Okay.
Correct.
So tell me a little bit more about yourself.
Sure.
I want you to essentially introduce yourself.
Okay.
And give me kind of like the comic book kind of story of how this all originated. Like
sure.
you yourself first, and then okay. we'll go into Habitat for Humanity.
Well, welcome to Burlington.
Thank
this
you
is
very
fantastic.
Much.
I'm really excited to join us.
Thank
so,
you.
Yes, it's great. So let's talk a little bit about how I got here.
Yes.
So a guy who grew up in a small town went into commerce and marketing in university
okay.
and college and went back to school in college because mom always said, got to keep going, educate.
Got to get that degree.
Get that degree.
For sure.
And then eventually was very successful in the marketing and sales.
What town did you grow up
in? So Cambridge.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, what, some people, eh, it's down
yeah,
the road.
Yeah, yeah, not too far
not
from here.
Too far from
yeah,
here.
Yeah.
So anyways, went off to school.
Yeah.
And I think I came pretty successful, young right. guy. Should have traveled a bit more, to be quite honest. But I didn't. I went right, right into work, right? What? So I was one of those guys.
Did you just have the passion for it? Like, was it, because I myself haven't traveled a lot either.
Yes.
And sometimes I look back and say, maybe I should have traveled a little bit more. But during that time of me working, I loved it so much. And I love it so much. I feel that kind of passion coming from
I love work.
Well.
So people say to me all the time, when you go home at night, what do you do?
yeah, yeah.
I write proposals. I read business books.
Yes.
And people look at me and they go, you're whack.
But it's not work for you. It seems like it's a hobby almost,
absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely. Listen. We're learning all the time.
Right.
If we don't learn, then I think we don't advance opportunities.
And it's so funny that you mentioned that because that's one of the main reasons we came out with this podcast. We're up to about 85 episodes now.
Wow.
And it really started to take a life of its own when we decided that, hey, look, it'd be kind of neat if people who are watching, I mean, we brought the cameras out a little later, but people who are essentially listening while they're driving or on the treadmill, taking their dog for a walk, they can be a fly on the wall of a conversation we're about to have.
Absolutely.
Right? And they can learn while doing something else.
Listen, and advocate. And
right.
learn, and then action on that learning.
Right.
right? Listen, we all know a very small amount of what's
yeah,
going on in
so
the world.
True.
So all of this information, knowledge, it's power, right?
So mom said, go to college.
Mom said, go do something.
Yeah.
And,
I love that. Yeah.
Make some money and go do something.
Yeah.
So I traveled for a bit and
okay.
came back and worked in the marketing. I my first job, I worked for a company called Big V Drugstore. It's a little small drugstore
okay.
chain.
Yeah.
And I was the mascot. Can you believe it? So I was the guy that wore the suit and the grand openings. And
what was it? Like, what was the
mascot? It was called the Crusader.
Okay, cool.
You know,
like superhero,
oh, superhero kind of crusader guy.
I gotta find a picture or something because we're gonna put that into post production. I need like some type of video of that because I want to see
there
this.
You go.
That's awesome.
There you go.
Okay.
I was the voice.
Yeah.
I was the body. So I was that poor guy that the kids kicked in the park
Got
when
it.
You couldn't
yeah,
see behind
yeah,
you.
Yeah, yeah, yeah,
I'm
yeah.
that guy. Anyway, so I did that for a bit.
I love that you're still laughing about it because that's so neat because it didn't bother you that much. Obviously,
listen.
That's so cool.
You know what? A really great leader I had was a young pharmacist who was the president of Big V,
mm-hmm.
Norm Poole.
Okay.
And he, I remember him telling me one day, he said, you know, John, whatever you do, no matter what happens, you can't say anything when you're in this costume. And I remember the day that the kid in the park kicked me in the back and pushed me to the ground. And I really wanted to say something.
Nothing.
No, I got up there and waved.
True. I've never heard of mascots
oh my
speak
God.
Either.
Oh my
right?
God,
so that's
right?
really
so
cool.
It's fascinating, right? You got that whole character, that
yeah.
whole branding, the whole,
yeah.
that's where it started, right?
Awesome.
So it started there.
Love it.
So passionate, learned a lot, had some really great mentors
mm-hmm.
through there. Anyways, long story short,
yeah.
did some sales, worked in some ad agency,
okay.
Worked in retail for a bit, in marketing and operations. Which brought me to the last part of my journey, which was international sales.
Okay.
And so I found myself traveling
well, that's neat.
6 days a week.
Mm-hmm.
Had two young kids in a marriage that
right.
was good.
Right.
But I didn't see things happening. And so one day my oldest daughter
yep.
Said to me, she was five at the time, Dad, I wanted to learn how to ride my bike. We live in the country.
Okay.
So you can't ride on the road.
Right.
Traffic.
Sure.
So we have to do the driveway thing.
Right.
Long story short, I come home one night. She's taught herself how to ride a bike. To be quite honest, it was life-changing for me.
Okay.
In the sense that I missed an opportunity, and I thought that having a great job and making lots of money and my family would all be excited. And I missed a moment, and I went into work a week later, thought about it for the entire week, and just quit.
Wow.
Now, the bad news is when I got home and told my wife what I had done,
I know where this didn't
go very well. So when people say, how did you come to Habitat? And people go, wow, you must have been passionate about Habitat. You must have learned about Habitat. Yeah. I said, no, my wife's Dutch. And for all those folks listening, you know, God love her. She is a wonderful woman. But you know what? In a roundabout way.
Yeah.
She had me interview the next day. I didn't even know.
We have another Dutch in this room.
We have another Dutch. Laura. There we go. So very focused. I like it. Numbers are good. So to all those people listening, I'm not being offensive. I'm just telling you the real reality.
It's true.
I'm out there Tuesday morning, I think, in the garden.
Okay.
With my boxer dog.
Yeah.
I'm having the greatest time. I have no work. I'm not, you know, I'm enjoying my life.
Yeah.
She drives in. She goes, you have an interview at Habitat tomorrow at 2. And here I am.
How long ago was this, by the way?
This is now 8 years ago.
Wow.
So, yeah. And
so did you come to this location?
I came to this location and met with a great group of board members.
Okay.
And 7 interviews.
Wow.
It was more complex than an interview I'd ever had in a business.
With almost all the board, like, was it individual?
No, it was an interesting mix of leaders. First, you had a quick round of the selection crew.
Got it.
And then you met the chair.
Yeah.
And then eventually you met a little bit more of the mix of the board.
Got it.
12 board members. Everybody wants.
Wow. Everybody. Sorry to the board listening. Yeah. Everybody wants their thoughts, right?
But it's cool, right? Because they take it very seriously, obviously, absolutely, right? For somebody to run an organization. So, how many people are in this office right now?
So when I started, there was 10.
We're now
up to 62.
Wow, in 8 years.
In 8 years.
And so, I love that the fact that those 12 board members had the vision that they knew that they're obviously going to be able to grow to that those numbers. But having 62 people that you work, I like to say that you work for.
Agree, 100%.
Right? What is your thoughts on that, though, like, as the leader?
Listen, capacity and scale. We build housing.
Right.
So when I joined, we were building one home a year.
Okay.
Let's be honest, Jazz. We were irrelevant.
Right.
If the housing situation out there, just as a business, right?
Right.
The business solution is X. Here's my problem. Here I need to sell X to Y. We were trying to sell X to Y at one unit a year. We'd be bankrupt in a for-profit environment. So I said to the board, we got to change what we're doing. And they bought into the vision of being innovative and capacity and scale. And so today we're building 22 homes. And we have the top restores in the country in this location. We are probably the most innovative in Canada in the sense of our building strategies. So we're building tiny homes and hotels for transitional housing. We're doing a lot of different things. And I think that's why the organization is the size it is.
I want to talk a little bit more about the innovation in a second.
Sure.
Before we go there, talk high level Habitat for Humanity.
Absolutely.
And then bring it down to like what Halton and this location does and what you guys do here.
For
Because we've heard of Habitat for Humanity, and I've heard about it from the perspective of like the American branding and reputation it has. And then obviously you do a little bit more research, you see that, there's Canada as well.
Correct.
Oh, and then there's like Toronto and Halton, Mississauga.
Absolutely.
So I really want you to talk a little bit more about that for my viewers and listeners.
Absolutely.
Because there's some people that don't even know Habitat for Humanity. And then there's probably more people who know it just like I do, like with the branding from a Canada and US perspective.
Absolutely. Well, and listen, the number one thing is people think Jimmy Carter started our organization.
Yes, which is kind of cool too.
Which is kind of cool,
yeah,
but
right?
It's not.
Yeah.
He's just a really big advocate. So
got it.
You happen to watch him on Facebook right now. There's a Facebook ad going around. He's down and out, but he's still building.
Interesting.
Know, God love him. He's
Did he start it?
No.
Oh, okay.
He just became an advocate.
That's it.
And him and his wife, they build every year.
Yep.
Every year. And, you know.
Well, for our millennials, Jimmy Carter was, I forget what number of president he was.
That's a good question.
We'll bring it up in
post
history or something, but he's an ex-president of the United States of America.
Very Democrat.
Yes.
Very socially driven.
Yes.
Probably one of the most socially driven presidents in U.S. history.
Yep.
And housing was a big thing for him.
Okay.
And so he basically continued. However, Habitat started with a gentleman named Mr. Fullard.
Okay.
Mr. Fullard basically started in the South, basically deciding that the only way people could get out of poverty is to earn equity.
Okay.
In something.
I love that.
Right? housing is the best thing, form of equity appreciation you could ever earn.
Well, that's music to my listeners' ears because that's the business that we're in.
Absolutely.
So I totally agree. So continue.
So he started by saying that we needed to rally communities. So Miller Fuller was a philanthropist.
Yep.
He gave everything he owned up for a cause.
Okay.
And he's still involved today, not so much with Habitat, but another part of his own foundation.
Okay.
But so Habitat started off in the U.S.
Yep.
In what I would call a movement, in the sense now it's international. It's
right.
All over the world.
Wow.
And there's a difference between the U.S. and Canada. And this is the big difference. In the U.S., they're very faith Christian based still.
Okay.
And that's just the way they are. That's
right.
the format. Canada, we are not. We are multi faith-based.
Right.
Primarily because I think of the diversity here and a little bit of
for
the difference.
Sure. That makes sense to me.
Absolutely.
Yes.
So, you know, you got international, which is around the world,
yep.
And you've got different countries like us and Canada and the U.S. and,
yep.
and, you know, different places. And then what you do is within the country, we then have what we call affiliates.
Okay.
So there are 54 of us across the country. 54
okay.
individual charities.
Wow.
Operating in individual communities.
Okay.
And that's how you get to that little bit of that local grassroots. So in Ontario, we have 25 affiliates, to put it in perspective.
Yep.
And in Manitoba, we got one. Right?
Right.
To put in perspective.
Just it's a population thing, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. So, you know, across the country, we've got 54. In the U.S., they have thousands of chapters
right.
of affiliates. So,
okay.
again, it's all about population density, size, and scale. So that's how Habitat exists, and it is a not-for-profit charity.
Okay, so I wanted to make sure that you made mention of that. It is non-for-profit. So how does a family get selected for a home?
Good question. So that's changing. Actually, if I was to tell you, you know, 30 years, 20 years ago, it was a very specific kind of process.
Mm-hmm.
And you will know from real estate how it's changed immensely in the last few years.
For sure.
Even decades, it's changed rapidly in how we deal with things. Same with how we select families. So families are required to contribute no more than 30% of their income.
Okay.
That is to ensure that they can afford other items.
Okay.
Because as we know in our case,
right.
if you can't afford shelter,
yep.
or you are paying more than 30% for shelter,
right.
you can't put food on the table, you have a fight or flight methodology around clothing and kids can't be educated,
sure.
and you can't get proper health care because you can't get dental because it's too expensive. So Miller Fuller's idea was, if we can cap housing, you can do all the other things in life, you can be more healthy, you can be, you can spend time in re-educating yourself, you can be better. You can better yourself. And so,
especially when you know you got a roof over your head, right?
Safety. It's all about safety, right? I come home at night, I don't have to worry about certain things. So Miller's big line was, it's not a handout.
Right.
The whole organization was about a hand up. We don't want to give things away.
Right.
We're there to help, right? Just extend help. A lot of people feel we give homes away. That's the biggest myth in Habitat.
Okay.
Families have to buy their homes.
Right.
But they buy it at a no interest mortgage.
Yes.
So they can afford it over a long period of time, earn equity and appreciation.
Right.
And now they have a safe support.
It's almost like a partnership.
Absolutely.
Right?
It
truly is. How do volunteers get involved?
So again, we have everything from folks that are doing community hours.
Okay.
To young people doing their 40 hours. To seniors that have been with us for 10 years who have retired. Engineers who are just like, I got to get out of the house.
Right.
I got to do something.
There's actually a gentleman on our site, which I forget his name, who's just amazing. His energy was awesome. Eric, it could
maybe.
Be. And he's been at that Malton Mississauga site for a very long time, since it started. And you could just tell, like, he just wanted to get out. He wanted to be part of the community, work with us. He had a blast with us as well.
Okay. But you know what? That's what's power here. So in our organization, 80% is done by volunteers still.
Okay.
80%. So without our volunteer force,
right.
we're not where we are today. So think about it. We're building homes
right.
with 80% volunteers. I know Matt and me would love to figure out how we do that.
So would any of the other developers
absolutely.
We deal
right?
with.
Right? Talk about margins, right?
Yes,
we could increase margins well. However, in saying that, that's the power.
Right.
The community power, people give back, they want to learn. We have people that come on our site. Listen, I'm sure some of your folks came out and said, I've never used a table saw, never used a drill, never.
Yeah.
It's very simple.
That was me.
There you go.
My team, but me for sure. I ended up getting the hammer to the nail like pretty good, but my team rocked it out. Some of these guys really, really wanted to do this. And so
fantastic.
It's nice to see not only, you know, corporations doing this, but just like the vast people that you just spoke about. You have seniors, you have young, you have the millennials Absolutely. Wanting to do this, right? It's nice to see volunteers come out and help.
People leave. People always leave by saying they've learned something.
For sure.
You know, we had a group, OMDREB, a real estate group over in Oakville Milton Real Estate Board,
okay.
who did a house a couple years ago, and they had to do what we call fire caulking. And fire caulking is a blue, kind of this awful looking caulking they have to put across the walls and down
Got
the
it.
Sides.
Got it.
And we had, God love some folks, they came out, they looked like Smurfs, right? It was just, they had more on them than they had in the project,
and
right?
the actual walls.
And the walls.
I love
but
it.
You know what? They came out going, wow, I can go home and tell whoever, my husband, my wife, I know how to do fire caulking.
I've done this before.
That's right. You may never have to do that ever again.
Probably never.
But it does give you a good, it gives you a good feel and people leave with,
Yeah, it actually, from our perspective, it just gave us, you know, the team building that it really helped that. So much so that we're going to be doing this on an annual basis.
That's
I was telling
fantastic.
The rest of the team, like, this is a no-brainer for us, not only because we're in real estate, just because it makes sense. Like, we had so much fun doing
Absolutely.
It.
Absolutely.
And knowing that there's going to be a family that is in need and we're going to be helping a family was almost a bonus, right?
Like Absolutely.
And such a nice bonus at that.
And you know what? I don't want to downplay, you made a comment about the real estate industry. This is such a natural tie-in. When we talk about that we renovate homes and we do salvages in homes and we have a handyman program, all mm-hmm. these other things, it's all related to housing, which is what
yes.
you're in the business of, right? So in the end for us, it's a natural tie to work together because we're putting families who are eventually going to sell those homes one day and go on to something better.
So
their
true.
Kids are going to be able to invest in a home for the very first time. It's just, it gives you a great feeling.
Well, look, I didn't even know how we could get in touch with Habitat.
Right.
Like it seemed like it, because it was such a no-brainer,
sure.
at one point it just seemed like, yeah, like I don't know how to get in touch.
Right.
And once we did, your team like rocked it on. I'm not only talking about the guys at the site,
yes.
but just everyone.
Right.
I know Julie doesn't want to be on camera, so I'm going to still give her a shout
Absolutely.
Out.
Absolutely.
And we had Melissa and just everyone there.
Fantastic.
Just made it so easy. I think
right.
that was the best. That's probably the best thing I can say,
right.
John, is that they made it very easy and removed the friction for us. It was
Correct.
Quite easy for us to get out and the safety and all that. So I want to go back to
sure.
how does someone actually get involved? Like,
Absolutely.
Like pick up the phone and call? Like, what's the best way to get
Best
involved.
Way, pick up the phone and call.
Got it.
Find out, go to Google.
Okay.
I hate to give a plug. Nope,
Got it.
I'm good.
No worries.
Yeah, Google.
No worries. Yeah.
So go to the websites,
Kay.
Type in your local habitat. You'll find out where your local habitat is. And then each one kind of operates a little differently.
Right.
For us, you can do it online. You can be on site in 30 minutes. You don't have to talk to a single person. You can
right.
fill out the paperwork, pick your site you want to be at. You're registered and you can start within 30 minutes.
And now it doesn't have to be what we did, which was actually at the home.
Absolutely.
Building. What's some other ways that people can get involved?
So the great thing is that's, I think, what we do really well here.
Okay.
Because some people feel intimidated by a build.
Mm-hmm.
The other part I like about the build is it makes everyone equal.
Explain.
Right? So unless you're coming with a great deal
right.
of construction experience,
right.
you know, when you're in an office
it's
environment,
yeah.
everyone's got their expertise.
Yeah.
But
yes.
when you come out to a build,
yeah.
you're all like everybody else.
I'm telling you, that's what the team loved the most. Because they really saw me at my worst.
That's fantastic.
Because I could not do much. So there's other podcast episodes that I say, I have a tough time hanging up a shelf on the wall, but now they really got to see that I was at my worst and it was really
before
cool.
and after.
Yeah, listen, before and after, it's true.
As I always say, we all have our separate skills.
Yeah,
I run the organization. My team will tell you, John, don't come out on the build. I am not one of those people. So everyone's got their for their skill. But yeah, you can volunteer in any part of it. So
okay.
we have a social enterprise called The Restore.
Okay.
And the social enterprise, it's a thrift, home building thrift store.
Okay.
And basically there are 150 across the country.
Yep.
These, we get a lot of our volunteers here. And so these are where people donate product.
Okay.
100% donated. We resell.
Yep.
And that helps raise money to build homes.
Okay.
And so you can volunteer in our, you know, if you're kind of like a merchandising, kind
right.
of a business person.
Right.
Or you like to fix things.
Yep.
The Restore is a great piece.
Is that the indoor
That's
facility?
The indoor facility.
Okay.
And then you've got Revive, which is an upcycling center.
Okay.
So where we upcycle product and we resell product. So something will come in instead of going to waste. We'll finesse it a bit.
Are we talking about like furniture?
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, okay, so a couch will come in
for sure,
and
the leg will be broken,
got
or
it.
The fabric's torn. We'll replace it, refinish it, and resell it.
That might be something neat for us to do the next time around. Just absolutely. To try all 2, 3, 4 different things.
For sure.
Because like I said, this is annual for us, and God willingly, we're going to be doing this for the next 50 years.
We got to get you out to a whole bunch of things.
I definitely want the whole a la carte menu.
Absolutely.
It seems like that you can kind of pick and choose what you'd like Correct. To do. Is there a need in all of like the station, so to speak, like at the site, at the Revive Center? Is there one more than the other that
no.
you feel?
No, okay. You know what it Got is? It. I think it's really important.
Okay.
Any volunteer, say you're a marketing guy.
Right.
You want to come.
Yeah.
You can work in our office, right? You can work on the website. You can work on mailing. You can work on phone. You can work in a call center.
Okay.
You can work in, so we never turn a volunteer away, right? Because the volunteer is our front line. It's the folks that come out to your house and pick up the product. It's the person that greets you on site sometimes and says, welcome. It's that gentleman you met in our Malton property.
Right.
These are ambassadors to us. I mean, they sometimes are more protective of the brand than staff.
I love it.
Right? And that's what makes it powerful. You walk into our ReStore next door and you say, this has $25 on it. I'll give you $10. You better hold on because there's going to be one of those volunteers going to say, do you know we're a charity?
Right.
$25. You're not going to go down, right?
I love that.
It's funny, right? It reinforces what we're all about. We're about bringing the community together, which is the power of the volunteer.
Yes.
And then empowering them. So we have international builds.
Okay.
Youth can go on international, but you can go anywhere in the world. So you want to go to Argentina with us? We'll take you to Argentina with us this year.
And you can go see what's going on. Because I have a feeling my team, when we're in the car, they're gonna mention that. So we're gonna edit that part out. But I do like I love the fact that we can do this internationally.
Absolutely,
my head's turning while you say that.
Right.
Talk to me about some new and exciting innovations that are coming up. Because I know you guys have some exciting stuff coming up and down the pipe.
We've got to be innovative.
Okay.
No different than your industry and the industry you're doing here and the people you're talking to. It's always about innovative. It's always about kind of that new piece. So this year, we're building tiny homes with the high schools in our area.
Okay.
So 4 tiny homes. First time we built tiny homes.
What does this mean?
This basically going to mean that 4 individuals can take these tiny homes and put them anywhere in the country. They're on wheels. They travel around.
Give me a size of a home.
10 by 14.
Whoa. Okay.
Compact on a trailer, hooked up to a truck, and away you go.
And where would you build that?
Those are going to be built at 2 high schools in Milton and Georgetown.
That is
our first
prize. Really cool.
It's very cool.
And how long does this take to build?
It takes about 4 months to build.
Okay.
And it's a project in tandem with
What's
skills
the material?
Development.
Because I'm really curious.
No, it's mostly steel.
Okay.
So steel on the outside because it is a trailer. It's a licensed trailer.
Okay.
Inside, it'll have a working toilet and running water and a propane, and you'll have a small bed and a kitchen and a pullout. And it's literally 10 by 14. And you know, there's a lot happening around the world on this, and if we think about it really from the perspective of folks that are struggling to live and people that are living on the street, tiny homes could change the world if we just, but we got to get around planning. We got to get around the planning
and the zoning. That could
Love
be
that
a,
conversation.
A 5-hour podcast for us because we have some issues in that sense too, because we just don't have enough inventory right now.
Absolutely.
And I won't go off on a rant on that, but at the end of the day,
I'm with you.
Yeah, you understand it, right? Like it's just everyone's looking at the demand side. What we need to look at is at the supply side. So this tiny home thing is really, really cool to me.
And that is the entry part, right?
Right.
And then we're doing some housing with a hotel.
Okay.
So we're actually building a hotel.
Wow.
And because
Congrats.
Talk about planning.
Yes.
Get around planning. Got to come up with different strategies. So we're looking at building the housing hub, the Habitat Housing Hub, which will house 5 different organizations in transitional housing.
Okay.
So what happens is these organizations will have a floor. They'll be able to support their, so this will be women running away from domestic violence.
Right.
Women that are being sexually trafficked. This could be seniors. This could be LGBT community. Basically what we're trying to do is build a center where they can get the supports, transitional, but yet it's supported by Habitat in an environment which meets the planning.
Is that going to be in Halton and Mississauga?
Yeah, we're the first ones pitching it. We should hopefully have something in the ground by 2020. We're really excited about it. So
amazing.
It's a...
How does a family, like we spoke about, how they would qualify per se, can they apply online?
Absolutely.
Okay.
So really the family comes back to their income.
Okay.
They have to be within a certain income bracket between $22,000 and $60,000 a year. They have to be hardworking in the sense what we define hardworking as you're attempting to work and you're trying to do the best thing for your family.
Sure.
And then they basically make sure they have to have a limited amount of debt.
Okay.
And in the end, they can't bring any assets to the table. So we're really trying to get the most needy of all families, right?
I love that.
And so they apply. Anyone can apply. You can go through an online system in some affiliates. You can call some affiliates. You can go in for an interview in some.
Right.
And then it's basically anywhere from a 2-month to a 6-month process. Home visits, interviews, financial reviews, home financial education.
So there's a long process.
It is a long process.
To make sure that the home gets in the right hands.
And that's it. I mean, we have thousands of people on the waiting list. I mean, that's how sad it is, right? Thousands. And we're building 22. Again, we're not quite there yet.
Right.
We've got some new things coming down the pipe.
Right.
But I think in the end, when you're talking thousands of people, you want to make sure the right people are selected.
Right.
And the ones that are going to ultimately grow, because we want these folks to be successful, right?
Right.
The 5 years from now, I want them to have bettered themselves. I want them to, you know, have their kids off to education and a generational change, right?
It goes that back whole to idea. What you said, the hand up.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
It's really helping from that perspective.
Change the cycle.
I love that.
Stop the poverty cycle, because it sometimes can be an ongoing, you can't get out of it.
You can't get out of it.
No.
It becomes like a vicious circle in
Absolutely.
That sense. I want to be very respectful of your time.
No problem.
I really appreciate not only you sitting down with me, but actually allowing us to do this at your place, at
this
your
great.
Office. Again, huge shout out to your team.
I appreciate
they
that.
They were amazing. And obviously all the people that I never got to meet, the people that probably never get any type of shout out, I really want to thank them as well.
Make sure they know.
Thank you. I really appreciate that. But at this time, I really just want to give you, was there anything that we didn't cover that you wanted to make sure that our viewers and our listeners got out of our conversation today?
You know, I think it goes back to the fundamental of what we're about. So, you know, we think about leadership. You know, one of the greatest leaders in my history, or one of the folks that I look up to, is Richard Branson, you know, and we talk here a lot about risk and reward.
Okay.
And if we're not prepared to take a risk, to try something different, to innovate differently, then we're never going to achieve a different outcome. And sometimes we win, and sometimes we don't. But if we don't take the chance to try something different, will never change the path in which we go. And I'm going to tell you, those nice comments are because the staff I work with, I really am proud of the group. They're all outside the box thinkers. They're about creating an environment of fun and enjoyment, because let's face it, you know, this could be a very challenging topic,
for sure.
Right? We deal with a lot of situations that are very critical, but in the end, we're building homes. We're giving keys to families. What better thing than I'm doing at the end of the day?
I'm very rarely can I be speechless. So I can't even add anything after that. Thank you, John.
Well, thanks for coming. I really appreciate you coming
out.
And your team, back to you.
Yes.
Your team are a good looking team, I gotta tell you.
I dressed them up today. There's a few people that weren't here, so shout out to those guys as well. But thank you so much.
Awesome. Thanks for having us.
For sure. Wow.
This has been the REC Experience Podcast with Jazz Takkar, an REC Canada production.
Hey guys, thanks so much for watching and listening. Please, please take a second right now to subscribe and follow us on whatever podcast platform you're watching or listening. It means the world to me. Thank you.